joints at night. I smoke two joints in the afternoon. This makes me feel alright. I smoke two joints in time of peace and two in time of war. I smoke two joints before I smoke two joints, and then I smoke two more.
Could barely see the screen.
Okay. Whoa. Whoa. This is not the other show. This is the last show. And this is the last show.
Part four of our three-part series.
Yeah, part four of our five-part series, Weed Wars.
It's four-part series.
Book report hopefully. On this book here, Smoke Signals by Martin Lee. Because we've heard so much about, you know, pot being a gateway drug and everything. We wanted to tell you about the studies. Now, according to our producer, engineer, and boss in general, we got up to about...
The 80s.
Yeah, the 80s, the 1980s. But we'll go right through this very quickly right here. All right. The 1894 British Indian Hemp Commission, it showed that there was no problem with ganja. Okay, that brought us up to 1944. This is seven, eight years after they made weed illegal in 1937. The LaGuardia report showed that there was no problem with it, okay?
Nope.
Yeah, just like it says right there, for those of you who can't read.
He was a mayor.
Yeah, DeMille. And the 1968 British Wooten report said it was less dangerous than pills and alcohol. It was not lead to harm drugs. Now, no harmful effects. That means it's not a gateway drug.
Not really, no.
As the locals here in Vermont kept saying. And then, when they were going to change it here in the USA, that's right, in the 1970s, they commissioned the Schaefer Commission. And they wanted it to come down on weed, but they found just the opposite, that there were no physical or psychological harm, no brain or birth brain damage or birth defects, and no danger to public safety. None. Okay, so that brings us up to the nurses study, the University of Massachusetts nurses study. Now, what are they? Yeah, I mean, yeah, what do nurses know, Andy? What does a nurse in college know?
More than the doctors, usually.
Yeah, really. That's the old saw, you know. If you need to know something, ask a nurse, for crying out loud. So anyways, we told you about the medical call. This the first one, and it was starting in 1974, the Medical College of Virginia. They found that, they kept finding that weed helps with bronchitis, and then with the lab animals, the mice didn't get cancer, and stuff like that. So anyways, so the nurses, they knew that the Jamaicans smoked a lot of weed, right, Andy?
Mm-hmm.
So the UMass School of Nursing had a study commissioned, and let's see. It was the NIDA, the National Institute of Drug Abuse, because you know those people are looking for something bad about weed, and they couldn't find it. And so the UMass nursing study, it was published, it was done in the 1980s, and it was published in Pediatrics 1994. And with the infants, this is page 147. So if you bear with me, I'll get back to page 147. Oh, man, we're not even going to get into the CIA stuff.
We did this, though. Want to restart? Because I remember you talked about the infants, and there was no difference in the infants with or without.
Yeah.
We were pretty thorough on that, actually.
Okay, so, all right, well, we'll bypass that. It basically, they tried to find a difference between the mothers who smoked weed and the infants and the ones who didn't.
And it
was actually the opposite.
Yeah, the ones who smoked, we were actually at a calmer situation.
Yeah.
Less tense.
Happier babies,
eating better.
Yeah, all right. So we'll get up to 162. This is the Poland study. And let's see, William Poland, that's 162. Because, you know, the Reagan thing would just say no and yada, yada, yada. Well, it didn't work. It didn't. The guy purged the studies. It said First Lady Nancy Reagan admonished everyone to just say no, said there's no middle ground, and To declare for a new intolerance towards weed smokers and other people. If you're a casual user, you're an accomplice to murder, said Nancy. And according to this, Nancy was not a casual user. She was a chronic user of prescription tranquilizers, according to her daughter, Patty Davis. But anyways, the NIDA director, William Paulin, ordered his staff to purge any NIDA published booklets, papers, and monographs on marijuana that contained the word social. 64 publications, some predating the NIDA's inception in 1974, were blacklisted. And every public library in the United States received an NIDA letter suggesting the offending documents were outdated and need to be pulled. Now, who else pulled information and burned books, Andy?
Well, that would be Hitler.
Hitler. For our younger folks, who was Hitler, Andy?
Yeah, Hitler was the most effective leader Germany ever had. He's actually a tamer version of Angela Merkel, their current chancellor. But he killed a lot of people unreasonably.
Yes, 4 to 6 million Jews, gypsies, homosexuals, communists! And Daryl Gates, man, he said that weed smokers should be taken out and shot.
Oh, yeah, we talked about his son.
Yeah, oh, man.
His son liked to rob sporting goods stores to get the hardware to rob pharmacies for the pills he needed.
Oh, man.
Oh, well.
Jeez,
man. Son of the police chief.
Yeah, the son of the L.A. police chief. Go figure.
Yeah, he was a pretty violent guy.
And so you got the NIDA guy, the pollen purge, as they called it. And Newt Gingrich, of all people, sent a letter to the New England Journal of Medicine. Newt Gingrich, later became Speaker of the House, said the outdated federal prohibition of medical marijuana was corrupting the intent of state laws and depriving thousands of glaucoma and cancer patients of the medical care promised them by their state legislatures. Just like here, Andy.
Gingrich was on the side of people who needed help.
Yeah, go figure. And you know, we fought so hard to get this to get it legalized for medicinal uses here in Vermont, only to have hospitals and groups of physicians threaten to can any of their doctors who actually write scripts for the stuff.
That's not really right now.
No, you figure, right, Dave? Thanks. And let's see, Herb Rosenfeld, he was the second one to get the compassionate use. And supposedly, with the compassionate use thing, too, according to the federal government, everybody who got a compassionate use thing, they were supposed to follow these people and determine, you know, what the outcomes were. Yet, they never did that. Because, you know, they didn't want to find out people were getting actually better.
No, they don't want to know that it's good. Because it is good.
Yeah.
It does good things. I mean, remember the AIDS epidemic.
Yeah, and the Prozac.
Got people through it.
Prozac, too. Just when Prozac came out, they started handing that out like candy to everybody. And according to this month's High Times, too, 14 mass killings have been linked to Paxil and Prozac alone. The Columbine killers, Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold were on Zoloft and Luvox. The Newtown gunman, Lanza, and the Virginia Tech guy were taking undisclosed medications, and the Batman shooter was abusing Vicodin, supposedly. And there's 100,000 deaths a year from prescription drugs, which is more than all illegal drugs and drunk drivers combined.
Yep, they're bad. Prescription drugs are more dangerous than anything else out there.
And what did I hear yesterday? It's like 500,000 deaths a year to smoking-related incidences.
Okay, then.
You don't see them banning tobacco, though.
No.
Funny how that works.
They tax it a lot. They want more money for it.
Yeah, they're gonna try.
You're addicted to this, so we're going to pay more.
Yeah. So we're addicted to the money off this addictive nicotine.
There you go.
Okay. Introduced in 1988, Prozac quickly became the standard treatment for the blues. It was the Coca-Cola of health medications. And doctors pushed Prozac, which works by increasing the presence of serotonin in the brain, as a remedy for millions of unhappy people.
Okay then.
Yeah, and you weren't unhappy or blue or anything like that. You're just lacking in serotonin, and old Eli Lilly's gonna give you a helping hand.
Thank God for Eli Lilly.
Yeah. And what's more, Prozac and other serotonin boosting compounds had nasty side effects: headaches, nausea, loss of appetite, and libido.
Okay then.
What's libido, Andy, for our younger viewers?
What makes you want to have more babies than you should?
That's called child support checks.
Yes,
taking
indeed.
Pills to replace your serotonin will cause your body to cease to create it on its own ever again.
Oh, yeah, you think?
Cool. So it messes up your brain permanently when you take these pills they give you.
It shuts down the pathway. So I guess it's not a gateway drug. It's a gate-closing drug,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, shut you down. Take some serotonin pills.
Oh, man.
Geniuses.
And here we are. Oh, geez. Libido, liver failure, bone density depletion, increased risk of stroke, heart disease, and suicidal behavior. Now, how can a drug that causes suicidal behavior be called an antidepressant?
Well, it's kind of a juggling of concepts, I would imagine.
Yeah, how can it even be legal?
Well, you know.
Well, that's okay.
Does the FDA let it be?
Yeah, because, you know, you can't make Prozac at home like you can with this stuff.
Corporations paid a lot of money for it to be legal.
That's right.
Maybe if marijuana had a giant corporation behind it, it would be legal, too.
Well, if marijuana could only be grown and distributed by giant corporations.
Maybe if Bank of America owned all the marijuana, it would be legal.
Yeah, you think?
Or Goldman Sachs. Maybe it was Goldman Sachs and weed, it would be legal.
A study of American mothers and their babies found that fetal exposure to Prozac disrupted neurological development and increased the risk of autism and newborn heart defects. Now, look, what was autism rates when we were kids, Andy?
Tiny, non-existent. Now it's like common as the cold.
1 in 1,000. And now it's like 1 in 50.
1 in every other one.
Yeah, geez, Louise.
All of Congress.
Yeah, here we are. And nearly 1 in 3 infants born of women taking antidepressant drugs show signs of withdrawal.
Okay, then.
Exposed neonates had seizures, bluish skin color from a lack of oxygen, feeding difficulties, low blood sugar, rapid breathing, and other symptoms.
Cool. Gotta have children like that.
Yeah.
More pills, more children like that.
Bad weed. Yeah. Bad weed. And people in chronic pain are often depressed. Now, trust me, I've been to pain clinics. I've been to pain clinics at UMass Worcester. Allentown, and
In pain makes you sad. That's novel.
Oh yeah, geez, it took him a long time to figure that out.
You know,
I had a doctor one time tell me, he says, "I think you're depressed," and I says, "No, I'm not depressed. I says I'm angry." He said, "Why are you angry?" I said, "Oh, I'm angry because I went in for a simple surgery and came out with hepatitis C. Go figure."
Oops.
Yeah, it's okay. So, anyways. But taking big pharma antidepressants along with certain kinds of painkillers increase the likelihood of bleeding in the stomach.
Ooh, those are nice things that happen.
Yet cannabis, an healing herb long used as an analgesic and a mood enhancer, pose no such risk. Nor has marijuana ever been shown to harm the fetus or increase the risk of miscarriage. Medical writings from ancient India, Persia, and Greece mention the antidepressant properties of cannabis. And we even talked about this in a prior episode, too. Robert Burton, the English clergyman, touted the herb as a remedy for melancholy in 1621, the same year that the Pilgrims jumped onto Plymouth Rock. Go figure. And, oh, man. So, where does that bring us, Andy?
Hopefully the 90s.
Hopefully the 90s, really. Oh, man, oh, man. Oh, here we are. The NIDA's Charles Schuster, he was 169. He was an MD also. And he was, the U.S. government's supposed to, blah, 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 169, is that? Oh, my God, now I'm stumbling.
We can take a moment.
Yeah, no, I got it. 169, here it is. But the NIDA are. Results demonstrate, now this is a Missoula study. This is from Missoula, Montana. It doesn't say what the date is. We're into the late 80s or 90s. and the Missoula study showed that clinical effectiveness in these patients are treating glaucoma, chronic musculoskeletal pain, spasms and nausea, spasticity of multiple sclerosis too. All four patients are stable with respect to chronic conditions and taking many fewer standard pharmaceuticals than previously. These results would support the provision of clinical cannabis to a greater number of patients in need. We believe that cannabis can be a safe and effective medicine. Now, you can Google that. You don't have to believe me. Just Google the Missoula study. And in case you can't spell very well, it's M-I-S-S-O-U-L-A. And, but the National Institute on Drug Abuse wasn't keen on providing clinical cannabis. And they wouldn't give up the weed from old Mississippi, where the federal government grows it, the only legal source of reefer in the USA. And the same agency, the NIDA, was politically hostile to weed, served as a gatekeeper of its supply. And this guy, Dr. Charles Schuster, who headed the NIDA during Reagan's second term, recalled that he was under considerable pressure to find something wrong with marijuana. Consequently, the NIDA spent a major portion of its budget looking for marijuana's elusive negative effects, and they couldn't find any. And for many years, we tried to determine whether marijuana produced brain damage. We didn't, said Dr. Schuster. And continuously blocking the therapeutic-oriented research, the federal government favored drug companies that sought to pharmaceuticalize the pill by synthesizing the key active ingredient. Which brings us to another thing with the Marinol, Andy.
Doesn't work.
Yeah, not only does the Marinol not work, but yet Marinol is schedule two, because see, if it was schedule one, it has no supposed therapeutic use, along with heroin or LSD, okay? So what they did was they made Marinol schedule two so that the doctors could write the scripts. Now, how does that work? Yeah. The weed itself, that the plant that the stuff comes from, is schedule one, yet the pharmaceutical stuff that they want to sell you is schedule two.
Well, that's because they know they're lying. LSD is probably the most promising drug ever, and it will be the drug of the future once we, you know, get past all this greed and stupidity and we killed off everybody and we have to do the right thing.
Yeah, when the geezers finally tip over.
The United States Army knows how effective it is. It uses it to cure alcoholism. So do the Marine Corps. There are secret programs used every day in which LSD is used in massive doses to make effective cures really quickly. So, but anyway, that's all top secret.
Yeah, and not only that too, but Ibogaine. Yeah, they've been used Ibogaine for years and years too for alcoholism and for with heroin, and it works for heroin. But Ibogaine, oh no, they can do it in Canada, but not here.
Yeah, no curing stuff here. It gets in the way of the money making.
Yeah.
Obamacare is all about the ching. It's about nothing but the money. Obama's about nothing but money. You know, he ain't black. He ain't white. He's green. He's green inside. That's just a green tint showing.
It's funny you mentioned that, Andy, because the only black teacher I had in school, Carl Douglas, God bless him, he died of a brain tumor. He should have been a viper. But he used to tell us, you know, on the rare occasions he even spoke of race, because, I mean, man, he didn't want to get Mr. Douglas mad at you. He said, look, when you guys get out in the real world, you'll find out there ain't no black and there ain't no white and there ain't no brown. It's all about the green.
It's all about the ching.
And here's a good book, too, for those of you who like to read. Michael Pollan, the guy who wrote The Omnivore's Dilemma, he wrote a book called The Botany of Desire. And he said the plant adapted more brilliantly to a strange new environment than anyone could have expected. For cannabis, the drug war is what global warming will be for much of the rest of the plant world. A cataclysm some species will turn into a great opportunity to expand their range. It's ironic, he noted, that the creation of a powerful new taboo against marijuana led directly to the creation of a powerful new plant.
Jed.
And there's a great PBS show on that, too, on Michael Pollan and the weed. But, you know...
It's going to get better. Weed's getting better.
Yeah.
Growing nicer strains. It's evolving.
Ooh. Yeah, and there's, you know, and God forbid they won't let us, you know, I've asked about this to see if we could use UVM to test it, because if I mail samples to Colorado, I could get busted for, you know, what do they call it, mail fraud or... Wire fraud.
Oh, really?
Yeah, or there's a thing they say for using the mails. But anyways, and the Dutch, oh man, OCD too. Oh God, they don't even want to mention that with obsessive compulsive disorder.
Marijuana probably helps those poor lunatics. What do you think?
Well, it does, yeah. It stops them from washing their hands every 2 seconds.
You know? But then the water people would be sad because then their water usage would go down. It's all about the chain.
Oh, and you know how we told you about the CIA bringing hard drugs in? You know, go figure. I mean, heroin's the cheapest it's ever been. Adjusted for inflation, a bag of heroin would be like $50 now, right, Andy?
That's awesome.
But it isn't. It's adjusted for inflation, a bag of junk is only like, I don't know, $10-$20.
Yep.
Well, you 20 in Vermont, 10 in Springfield, Mass, from what I hear. Excuse me, I gotta stop eating those sardine and garlic sandwiches.
No, love
and,
that.
Yeah, 1984, now Barry Seal, you can Google him. Or Google the guy, I can't remember the reporter's name, who broke the story about the Contras and the cocaine. But Barry Seal was one of the runners. And in 1984, he became a key DEA witness in the U.S. government's case about the Medellin cartel. That's Colombian. And later that year, he was caught flying a boatload of weed into Louisiana, but the charges were dropped. And in 1984, Congress passed the Boland Amendment, which forbid the U.S. military to aid the Contra rebels. You know, the ones that Reagan said were our moral equivalent of our founding fathers, Andy?
Yeah, they were.
Yeah, sure. So
Ronnie never lied.
Seal's aviation talents were appreciated by Lieutenant Colonel Rolly North, who supervised the illicit Contra supply effort in cahoots with the CIA director, William Casey, who they removed half of his brain just a day before he was supposed to testify.
You know.
Now, how'd that happen, Andy?
Well, because, you know, Willie Casey ran the world. And then when he got found out, they killed him.
Yeah, yeah. He's supposed to testify before Congress, and then he supposedly has a stroke at his desk, and instead of just treating him with anti-clotting agents, boys and girls, they remove a quarter of his brain, his whole frontal lobe.
Well, the talking part.
Yeah.
The talking, thinking, deciding part.
Unbelievable.
Still could run the CIA pretty well.
And who was the guy they drowned who could swim like crazy?
Oh, man. Yeah, yeah.
Another CIA director. He got drowned, I mean, in 4 feet of water. He was out canoeing.
Willie. Yeah, Bill.
What the hell was his name?
Oh, no. I can't remember now either.
Yeah, just...
He was a friend of the family, too.
Just Google dead CIA directors. They silence themselves real quick. And so anyways, they work both sides of the street under government protection, returning with weed or cocaine from Latin America. And if you help the CIA's proxy army, the U.S. would look away when you smuggle drugs. And pegged by the DEA, one of the largest weed smugglers, Michael Palmer flew Contra missions for Vortex, a CIA front. When Palmer was indicted in Detroit in 86 for weed smuggling, and again in 89, he invoked his CIA ties and got off scot-free. This whole thing is too sleazy for words, remarked a State Department official. And in 1983, the U.S. Attorney General William French Smith secretly granted the CIA an exemption, sparing it from legal requirements to report on drug smuggling by agency assets.
Okay. Because they do all the drug smuggling. You can't. It's way too much to keep track of.
Yeah. So we you know, they smuggled in heroin from Vietnam when I was a kid. They smuggled in coke and weed during the 80s when Reagan was president. And we're just happened to be fighting a war and one of the largest poppy growing. You can see our boys guarding the weed and poppies in Afghanistan right in your own eyes. Who are you going to believe, me or your lying eyes, right? Yet we're supposed to not believe that they're bringing in heroin now when it's only $5 or $10 a bag.
Oh, they're bringing it in by the bucket load. There is no illegal trade.
Yeah.
It's all government work now.
Oh, man.
You cannot be a dope dealer unless you work for the federal government.
That's it.
A requirement.
Yeah. What's your G rating, man?
Exactly.
You got to be at least a G8 to smuggle heroin or wash the money like HSBC Bank.
DC is knee deep in cocaine. Somebody was like, my daughter's going off to DC. I go, Satan lives there. I don't think so. It's like, whatever. Believe what you want.
Yeah.
Be proud of your young thing going off the beltway.
Yeah.
Nothing goes wrong there. It's all above board.
Yeah, she'll come back in fine shape if she ever comes back at all.
Blistered knees and chapped lips.
Drugs and covert operations go together like fleas on a dog, said former CIA analyst David McMichael. Scratch the surface of the narcotics trade. Once again, it seems that certain drug dealers were okay by the CIA.
All of them were.
As long as they snorted the anti-commie line. And in 1989, Lieutenant Colonel North and three other U.S. officials were banned for life from Costa Rica after that parliament found hard evidence of CIA complicity in cocaine trafficking.
You think they actually noticed?
Yeah.
Wow, that's kind of amazing. Since then, Costa Rica's government has been fixed.
Yeah,
they don't whine about nothing anymore.
Yeah, we fixed them.
Want to retire? They even use American dollars. I think they even gave up on their own money.
That's it. Costa Rica is where all our agency assets go to retire, if you know what I mean.
Oliver North was more powerful than God when he ran the show. So.
Yeah, a report by Inspector General Frederick Hitz, H-I-T-Z, of the CIA, subsequently identified more than 50 Contras and Contra-related entities that were implicated in the drug trade.
Just 50?
Yeah, all while Reagan administration was purporting to wage a no-holds war on drugs.
Yeah, except for the stuff he owned himself, which was like all of it.
Yeah. Don't mention.
Don't smoke a joint, kid, but stay out of my 80,000 tons of heroin and coke.
Yeah. And don't mention drugs unless you've got enough to go around.
It's a rumor that Southwest Airlines was created as just an adjunct to all these Norse escapades. You know, he had all these planes flying around, moving blow. I mean, what are we going to do with all this stuff? Well, let's make an airline out of it.
Yeah. Yeah. Air America.
No, Southwest Airlines, the airline, the purple and the... The stewardess with gold teeth. You know, it's off the record. This is my opinion, but, check its origins.
Here's one for our engineer. During the 80s, according to data gathered by the Institute for Social Research at the University of Michigan, the use of weed declined among high school seniors while the use of cocaine increased, the exact opposite of what the gateway theory would have predicted. An article among faith of many drug warriors, the gateway theory maintained that smoking pot was a stepping stone to addictive narcotics.
Oh, heck no. Couldn't afford weed back then.
The more people who smoked weed, the more junkies and coke fiends. Numerous studies, however, have debunked this idea. And in 1982, the National Academy of Sciences... Now, what do they know, Andy?
Not much.
Yeah. The National Academy of Sciences reiterated the findings of the Schaefer Commission.
Oh, yeah, weed wasn't bad. Yeah.
Cannabis is not a gateway drug. Contrary to prohibitionist liturgy, statistical evidence indicated that less weed was associated with the wider use of more dangerous substances.
Government can't control weed. It grows too easily. I mean, I remember Reagan when he was all leaning on pot. Ounces were up to $500 in the late 80s. $500 an ounce. That's high now. But you could get you some crack for $3.
Yeah, it was.
Anyone could light up crack for next to nothing. For chump change, for bottle money, you could get you some cocaine.
Oh, dude, I made a lot of money in the 80s.
Yeah, well.
It was all working as a dual employment.
Reagan was a jerk, man. It was all BS. He's a liar. His wife was into astrology and banging Frank Sinatra on the Oval Office.
Joe, right, that woman...
Come get me, Ron. You know it's true.
That woman couldn't take her Valium without a say-so from her astrologer. Are you kidding me?
Oh, she'd take her Valium, trust me.
Oh, Ilona?
Oh, yeah.
Who?
Ilona. Wasn't she her astrologer?
Oh, man.
For a while.
I thought you was the one with the puffy hair from San Francisco, Gene Dixon.
Oh, yeah. Gene Dixon was everybody's best friend.
Oh, man.
She was a bit part actress for a while. She was kind of cute when she was younger.
Well, you know, it's funny you mention that because, you know, when they had that shipload of Jews that were fled Nazi Germany.
Oh, couldn't land anywhere?
They couldn't land anywhere.
Roosevelt didn't like Jews in America.
They
No Jews in Miami, no.
They went to Cuba. The Cubans wouldn't take them. They went to Miami, and they said, no way. So Roosevelt's daughter said to him, she says, Dad, can't we take them? And he's all like, no. And she says, well, what about the children? Can't we take the children?
No.
And you know what he says?
I got to hear that.
He said that the Jewish kids were like puppies. They're all cute when they're little, but they're going to grow up and old and they...
They'll grow up to be Jewish.
You're going to have a bunch of Jews. And so anyways, they turned him back. They went back to...
He was opposed to the Holocaust officially.
Yeah. And there's a memorial up in Newfoundland or wherever.
He never had sex with any of those women.
Yeah, never.
No,
never.
Except the ones that were there.
Except his cousin and wife, Eleanor.
No, Eleanor didn't get nothing. If you were a secretary, though, and if, you know, Admiral Canaris or the, you know, Gestapo had sent them, yeah, they're getting some.
Yeah, and so anyways, where do you think our loss of civil liberties came from, man? During the 80s, the initial response to illicit drug use was a tax on civil and political rights of minorities. The have-nots and the have-littles bore the brunt of Reaganomics, widened the gap between rich and poor, resulting in greater inequality, social dislocation, and 2 million homeless Americans. Reagan-era economic restructuring was accompanied by intense criminal justice crackdown. The war on drugs served as a pretext to keep plenty of police armed and ready should popular unrest ever reach a boiling point.
Well, he hated riots. He was a big anti-riot guy.
Police used drugs as a surrogate. It allowed them to arrest and harass a large segment of society. And for everyone else, there's the piss test.
That's made things better, hasn't it? America, you all pee in a cup now and...
Yeah, God. like we said before, you know.
Doesn't catch coke, doesn't catch LSD, won't catch speed.
Patty.
Alcohol can slip through.
Patty,
you there?
Patty. Yeah. And who's making money off the piss test, Andy?
Probably the cops, the GOP.
Yeah.
The Republican Party.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the hover round scam with Romney, you know. Wheelchairs and Republicans, piss tests and Republicans.
Yeah, I don't want the federal government taking away my Medicare.
Suppositories and Republicans.
That's it. We're old, we're drunk, angry, and constipated.
Yeah. They want to put stuff up your butt that monitors what you do.
Yeah, during the coke craze summer of 86, Reagan asked the government workers in crucial occupations be required to take random urine tests to ensure the workplace was drug-free. Now, what do you think George Washington would have said if they asked him to take a piss test?
He'd pee on them. I'll pee all over, whatever, I'll piss on your leg.
Yeah, that's where Reagan
got in the cup.
The tinkle down theory.
Now we don't worry about danger, and you know, we get rid of our air traffic controllers. Just let's fly blind.
Yeah, as we speak, while this is taping, there are flight delays all over the country because of a sequester that's got our air traffic controllers furloughed.
Yes.
Okay.
That was awesome. Yeah.
We can spend millions on the military, though, and plenty for the SWAT teams.
Don't the military have air traffic controllers? Can we borrow them? Or are they all hanging out in Kabul waiting for Al-Qaeda to blow them up?
Yeah, they're all fly-by-wire, man. It's all it's VFR for those guys.
God.
And, you know, it's only 12 hours from bottle
what
to throttle.
What happened to the 21st century?
That's it, man. That's it.
What a joke.
And, oh, geez. And the Iran-Contra affair blew wide open when Nicaraguan soldiers shot down an American C-120 cargo plane that was once owned by Barry Seal that was illegally delivering weapons to the rebels, anti-Sandinista rebels. Now, who was flying that plane, Andy? Who'd they capture?
Oh, the Marines, man.
Eugene Hassenfuss.
Okay, then.
Which is German for rabbit's foot.
Yeah, good luck.
Oh, man.
Worked for the Marines.
Yeah, I'm sure that was his real name, right?
Hassenfuss. You can tell the German Jews, they always name themselves after numbers, colors, or dates.
Yeah.
Schwartz, you know, Zwei.
Rothschild. And
he was French.
Rosenfeld.
Yeah, there you go.
Weiss.
That's red. See, Rosenfeld is, you know, red.
Rothschild. Redshield. Yeah, go figure.
Colors, days of the week.
Yeah, sure. Two first names, too. That usually works good in English.
It gives it away.
Oh, man. And John Kerry.
Look it up. We're kind of Jewish ourselves.
Yeah, John Kerry was still looking into this. And funny how he never piped up too much either.
Mm-hmm.
Now, during while all
Teresa
this was...
Teresa and Leonard.
While all this was going on, yeah, she loved them tomatoes. She was real
Shut
sad
up, boy.
Tomato. I heard that.
Go back to Massachusetts.
Yeah.
Get out the house.
And while all this was going on under Reagan's Just Say No crap, another narco quagmire was brewing in the Golden Trescent of Southwest Asia, where the highlands of Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Iran converge. This region became the largest source of heroin in the world during the 80s when the CIA trained and supplied the Mujahideen rebels who were fighting against the Soviet-backed regime in Kabul, Afghanistan.
Yeah.
Now, whatever happened to that, Andy?
Oh, we won, and then we quit.
We won!
Then we quit.
Yeah.
We walked away after winning.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right.
Charlie Wilson's War. It's a pretty good movie on the subject.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, man. And speaking of which, who is promoting all these private prisons and stuff, Andy? Would that
people
be
who are going to make money.
The American Legislative Exchange Council?
Wow, that's a good organization.
Yeah, yeah. They help our local people work out rules, you know? And all you have to do is cut and paste, and you can use it in any state you want.
So a star chamber that kind of coordinates what legislatures should do?
Exactly.
How cool is that? Why have elected officials when you can have the guy behind the scenes, the puppeteer, so to speak, just do what he wants?
Yeah, yeah, it's the Koch brothers. And the Chamber of Fascists, Arbeit macht frei.
There you go.
And so anyways, the price tag for the operation, for Charlie Wilson's War, was $3.2 billion, the most expensive undertaking in CIA history. And who's running the drones?
Officially.
And who's running the drones now, man?
No, they are.
Well, yeah, well, who was shuffling the weapons back then, Andy?
The Mujahideen.
No, I mean from us to them.
Oh, well, the CIA.
Well, no, one Wait. Country.
Who was supposed
Oi.
To? What?
Oi.
The Israelis?
The Israelis,
the
yeah.
When don't they... do anything. They just had the Palestinians do it.
Yeah, right. They wouldn't let a Palestinian handle an AK-47, let alone a red eye, a sting eye.
And...
and so anyways, the CIA essentially told the DEA to get lost for the duration of the war while the Mujahideen factions and their U.S.-based Pakistani benefactors profited mighty from the opium trade.
Well, somebody got a profit.
Yeah, the Reagan administration was mum regarding massive amounts of unaccounted U.S. aid for the Mujahideen, which helped grease a major arms for heroin pipeline in the war zone. And the U.S. news media, forever marveling at the so-called Teflon president, that would be Reagan, lacked the gumption to report the obvious. Reagan's war on drug was a sham so long as American intelligence supported groups that peddled narcotics. Real narcotics, like the opium we're showing you garden, the garden. Okay, Joe.
Wait a minute.
Photographed behind huge piles of cash and a cache of heroin or cocaine seized by law enforcement, Reagan blithely proclaimed that America was winning the war on drugs.
No, we did. It's all over.
We won.
There are no drugs anywhere.
That's right.
We totally won.
And then Congress passed harsh anti-drug legislation. And if any of your household was involved in a drug offense, you lost your benefits. If a black teenager smoked a joint on the corner, his grandmother could lose her apartment.
There you go.
And the forfeiture laws were expanded, and $1 billion in grant money was designated for state and local fuzz under the Edward Byrne Memorial State and Local Law Enforcement Assistance Program.
Sounds awesome.
An additional $5.5 billion was earmarked to train and equip police. Okay. But that's it. And
now our police are trained and equipped.
And now we're talking, yeah, now they're talking in Vermont that they've got the hemp bill so that, you know, Vermonters can grow hemp.
Yep.
But they don't mention that only if you get a DEA permit, and the DEA is not granting any permits.
Strange how that works.
Yeah. Now, and we told you about this before. I'm not sure if it was on this show or the other one, but that an acre of hemp grown during 120 to 180 day season produced the same amount of paper as 4 acres of 20-year-old trees. And hemp doesn't require pesticides or fertilizers. It actually enriches and replenishes the soil and provides an excellent rotation crop, according to the USDA.
Yep.
But, you know, nah.
80 times faster than trees to make paper. You can get 80 times more product off the same land. 80 times.
Oh, speaking of which, Patty, if maybe you can stick in that hemp for victory thing before we go out. Thank you. And from blunts to ballots, oh my God. Let's see. 91 studies. 17 million in assets in 1991. Acid hungry cops. Oh my God.
Hungry for acid? That's a good thing.
Oh, you know, assets, really.
Oh, acid hungry. Oh, well, that was acid. That'd be good.
And now, yeah, now researchers are looking into the other cannabinoid receptors, because you have over 1,000 receptors in your brain, right, Andy?
Yep.
And there's over 600 something chemicals in weed. Yet they won't, they still won't allow any testing on it, hardly any. But yet the researchers in other countries...
They don't want to discover a good thing.
Oh, hell no. The cannabinoid receptors, they're called CBs. And they've got CB2, CB3s, there's a whole bunch of them. And CB2, prevalent throughout the peripheral nervous system and the immune system, CB2 receptors are also present in the gut, spleen, liver, heart, kidneys, bone, blood vessels, lymph cells, endocrine glands, and reproductive organs. THC stimulates the CB2 receptor, but this doesn't usually result in the high that weed is famous for, because the CB2 receptors are not concentrated in the brain. THC binding to CB1, the central nervous receptor, causes the high, and the CB1 receptor mediates psychoactivity. So it's like a self-regulating thing, you know? Oh, my God, I forgot about this stupid intro we have to go through every time we put on this stupid thing.
About the train? You like
the
train?
Oh, yeah, you got to go through all this crap before you can get
it's
to
cool
the
stuff.
Damn, oh, yeah, yeah,
little dragsters.
Yeah, dragster. Oh, look out,
angry,
bad movies from
people.
The 70s. And, oh, there's the Planet of the Grapes. I mean, apes. And
monkeys riding bicycles.
Cannabinoid receptors recognize, respond to... three kinds of agonists, which are turn on the keys. Endogenous fatty acid cannabinoids found in all mammals. Phytocannabinoids concentrated in the oily resin, the buds and leaves. And potent synthetic cannabinoids concocted in the university and drug laboratories. Anandamine, a 2-AG impact organism, predominantly located. We'll get into the dandam. These are called endocannabinoids. These are cannabinoids that your body actually produces on its own, Andy.
So basically, marijuana is very similar to what your body already has inside of it.
Yeah,
it makes a connection with you in a good way, because it can.
I'm my own grandpa, evidently.
Yep.
Okay, now we're going to have to hit play. Finally, we made it through all that crap.
For victory.
Patty?
Yeah.
Okay. There it goes. Yay!
Hey,
here's a 1942 hemp for victory, because we threw out all the laws in 1942 when it looked like the Japs were going to kick our butts, Andy.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, well, that's different, though. That's during wartime. That's funny. We wanted to win that war, too, didn't we?
Yeah, we did. Well, kind of.
You know, during the war, they had ration coupons so that even rich people couldn't buy the stuff that poor people couldn't afford.
Cool.
Imagine that.
Yeah.
To each man according to his needs instead of his deeds or some stupid thing like that. I can't even remember the commie line. Anyway, scientists call it the endocannabinoid system, named after the plant that led to its discovery. Every animal except insects have it. It must be very important, basic physiology. And the International Cannabinoid Research Society, ICRS, go figure.
So basically, anti-drug people are trying to promote a world ruled by insects.
That's it. Or better yet, the limbic reptilian part of your brain that just responds to visual stimulation, you know.
The reptiles have cannabinoids in them.
Yeah, so you can stay at home in your mommy's basement.
Oh,
you know,
they're just into bug people.
Watch that. You know what?
The bug people shall rise.
Yeah, the one, you'd be down there.
Pills and bugs. That is our future.
Thank God you can operate a keyboard with one hand, if you know what I mean.
Pill bugs.
And yeah, and see, the ropes, the canvas, everything was made out of hemp at one time, boys and girls. But no, they don't want you to learn about that. And
I don't want you to know the truth about anything.
Anyways, a German research team would later demonstrate the CB2 receptors activation restrains the formation of bone reabsorbing cells known as osteoclasts by down-regulating osteoclast precursors, thus tipping the balance in favor of osteoblasts, the cells that facilitate bone formation.
Well, so it helps your bone structure and helps you heal.
And then
we told
you about the 74 study that said it, the Virginia Medical College, you know, we need to stop cancer dead in its tracks, but no! Oh, no, mister. Oh, no. If we can't make any money off it, you ain't going to get it. Unless you grow it yourself.
Yeah, they basically, in where I sit, they just want everything that's easily manufactured or grown to be illegal. Heroin gets rid of pain. Cocaine gets rid of pain. They're simple. They grow off of plants. Marijuana does hundreds of things. They don't want that. They do want you to take these pills that only they can manufacture because they're sulfa, alkaloid, petroleum products, plastics, you know.
Okay, so here we...
Chalk.
And fortunately, not fortunately, nobody wants to get AIDS, right? But one thing about the AIDS epidemic that opened up a lot of doors was it enabled research into compassionate use. So
yep.
Here's a study that's only 4 years old, boys and girls, right? In 2008, scientists at Harvard Medical School and Northeastern University. Now, those are like bottom-tier schools, aren't they, Andy?
Yeah, only idiots can go to Northeastern or Harvard.
Yeah, it's like a community college,
yeah,
right, Andy?
It's like if you, get kicked out of high school, you got to settle for Harvard.
So anyways,
nothing there.
At Harvard Northeastern found that the cannabinoid receptor activation strengthens the blood-brain barrier. Breakdown of the blood-brain barrier is frequently observed in patients with HIV-associated dementia. In the journal, cannabinoids inhibit H1V1 the endothelial cells. According to the Journal of Immunology, 181.9/2008, research at the University of Catania, Italy, showed that a synthetic cannabinoid, which binds the CB1 and CB2 receptors, decreases the viability of Kaposi's sarcoma. And that was published in the European Journal of Pharmacology. And
it reduces the horrible sarcomas. If you knew anyone with AIDS or witnessed that horrible, horrible disease.
It's a skin cancer, right?
It is just the worst kind of scabbing, painful lesions. It's just nasty. And marijuana alleviated agony. I mean, these were educated, smart, brilliant, wonderful people suffering in agony. And none of these 50, 60 pills they would take did anything to help the pain anywhere close to the marijuana they smoked. It was by necessity of just alleviating the morass of horror that marijuana got a little bit of a window in the 80s.
And last year, in 2012, researchers at Mount Sinai School of Medicine, that's like a punk school, man, isn't it, Andy?
It's the best of the best.
That's
really
like a medical school in Granada, right?
We're being sarcastic. They're amazing.
Yeah.
They are really good at what they do.
Researchers at Mount Sinai reported that cannabinoids that bind to CB2 receptors activate other receptors on human immune cells that directly inhibit viruses in late-stage AIDS. And that's published in PLOS1, March 20th, 2012. So you can go on the web and look up PLOS1. That's the journal. And there's tons and tons of research.
Yeah, marijuana inhibits the progress of viruses. Viruses are bad. Bacteria are bad. These things, marijuana helps alleviate. That means makes it better. So...
Well, we found...
Inhibits virus progress. Slows down the virus. That's a good thing.
Yeah.
You ask your doctor, like, don't you want me to get better? It's like, not really. I want you to languish on in agony while I just dose you up endlessly with my crap while I get rich. I want you to die a slow death. That's what doctors want. They don't want to cure anything.
Well, it's funny. They still take the Hippocratic Oath, as I call it.
Exactly. Hippocratic, exactly.
Because here's the thing, boys and girls. Now, this is a very brief story, and I won't mention the local pharmacist who told me this either, but if you go back through the local Chronic magazine or whatever, you can find this letter to the editor. This guy's a local pharmacist. He wrote a letter to the editor about the tenfold increase in prescriptions that he was writing, right? So I went to the drugstore where this guy worked, and I says, would you like to appear on camera so I could interview you? And he's all like, no, no, because he was already getting heat from his bosses about dissing the train, the shit train that's feeding him.
Mm-hmm.
So... Yeah, I said, look, we can black you out, we can do a voice change or whatever. And the guy or gal was so scared that they won't come on camera. It's insane. Yet they will let you languish because, it helps the...
There's no money in cures. There's no money in health. You know, there's money in disease, in maintaining disease. You know, they're addicted to the ching. It's all about the money.
Every time someone gets cancer, the GNP, gross national product, goes up.
Yep.
You know? And that's just the way it is. It's the way they measure it.
Bottom line, they don't want marijuana legal because it would help. And the last thing they want is you to get help. The last thing they want for you is to get better. The last thing they want is for you to abandon their crap. They want you to take all their pills. They'll give you pills by the boatload if you want them.
Well, here's the thing, Andy. It's embedded, it's the puritanical, the hate of pleasure. Embedded in America's cultural DNA, a lingering Puritan distrust of pleasure gives rise to the haunting fear that someone, somewhere, someday may be happy.
God.
Latter-day zealots for zero tolerance are a direct extension of old-fashioned Puritanism, which values hard work, discipline, and order, while shunning intoxication and merriment for its own sake is inherently immoral.
God,
to ardent drug warriors, all weed is recreational. They maintain that medical weed is a decoy, pretense for getting high, a ruse perpetuated by reprobates in a puff state to want to legalize all narcotics. Now, people talk about the value of Puritans and how, the shining city on the hill and stuff. Well, what did the first thing the shining people on the city on the hill want to do, Andy?
Slaughter all the Indians?
Yeah, right. Kill the Indians first because, hey, those heathens have got our land and we want it and we're going to take it. Secondly, they had no Christmas. They showed the pilgrims celebrating Thanksgiving. Are you kidding me? They might have sat down and ate and had a few prayers, but there was no partying. You couldn't celebrate any holidays, no Halloween, no Christmas, no nothing, because it was against the law to have fun. And basically, that's what a puritanical society says. And God forbid, if you're taking a I asked my doctor, I said, if the side effect of a medication is euphoria, is that considered an adverse event?
What did he say?
He couldn't answer me, Andy.
Okay,
he couldn't
then.
Or wouldn't answer me.
Okay, then.
Looks like there will be a part five because you only got 5 minutes to go.
Oh, we're wrapping it up this time.
2012.
Yeah.
That's last year.
Well, yeah, we're up to 2012, you know. Oh, Paxil, my God. Social anxiety disorder. And when it comes to drugs, they'll make up a disorder to sell you the drugs that you don't need. Because remember this, boys and girls, if it's not a disease, it's not real, okay? Now, they can have syndromes and disorders, but unless it's actually called a disease, they don't know. I'll give you that much, okay? So say you show up at a party and you're a little timid, they call that social anxiety disorder. And you got to take Paxil for that, because you don't want to go into a party and just sit in the corner and be afraid. No, you want to come in and just be start clap handing and, you know, and just be the life of the party. Right, Andy?
Why don't you just take mushrooms and quaaludes? Because that's what Paxil is. It's like a cross between them.
Oh, man, where do I get them then? I'd be afraid to drive on them.
That smells horrible.
A big issue is when Clinton allowed advertising of medicines on television, prescriptions increased exponentially, which means that because people were watching TV, they were getting sicker.
Exactly. And why is there no research coming from, you know, little countries, the little poor countries, Andy?
Yeah, because...
Well, because if they through our government, if you're getting U.S. aid, I mean, even Israel, our number one recipient of foreign aid, if you're getting U.S. aid, they'll threaten to decertify you as uncooperative in the global drug war, and the State Department wields leverage over third world country. And that loses American support for assistance and lending institutions such as the World Bank and the IMF, which stands for International MOFOs. The drug laws can be used selectively and sporadically against the poor or the otherwise undesirable, no means incidental. Their enforcement is a tremendous political and economic weapon against what we call the third world.
It's very arbitrary.
Arbitrary and capricious. This is the book right here. Patty Kammer 2.
Weed Wars.
Patty
Make
Kammer
it big,
2.
Dear. There
yeah.
you go.
Smoke signal.
Smoke signal.
And I swear to God, I'm going to make this available at all the local libraries. I will drop them off personally. So if the librarian says they don't have it,
they're lying.
They're BSing you.
They're lying.
Within 2 weeks of this show, we're taping on April 24th. So within 2 weeks, I'll have copies at every major library.
Look for it after May Fool's Day.
Yeah, after Memorial Day. That's a memorial for you. So once again, you haven't wasted an hour or 4 hours. You've learned a lot, and so have we. The most beneficial, harmless plant in the world that is not, repeat, not a gateway drug. So remember, boys and girls, grow hemp for the war. That's right, because you're looking at two veterans of the drug wars. He's a branch manager, and I'm the field marshal, and we've both got medals of honor in the war on drugs.
Yes,
take
we
it
do.
From us. There's good pills and bad pills, and there's ways to use them and ways to abuse them. So there you go. Stay away from the pills. You don't need them anyways.
They don't work. They make you bad.
They won't work. See ya.
Best you can. But then one day I met a man who came to me and said, hard work good and hard work fine, but first take care of health. So now I smoke two joints when I get up. In the car I smoke two joints. I smoke two joints when I play video game, and at every 10,000 points I smoke two joints. I smoke two joints in time of peace. Before I smoke two joints, and then I smoke two more. Man.
came to me and said, hard work good and hard work fine, just take care of head. That's why I
smoke two joints in the morning, I smoke two joints at night, I smoke two joints.